How are you?
I'm trying to be cool. How am I doing?
You're doing great.
I'm trying to be cool, too.
What's happening?
I just had to get it out. Hi.
How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm terrific.
Thank
you.
My voice is really hot. It's not...
Oh, no. Oh, you talking about my voice?
No, no,
okay,
me,
I was about to say, because I get like jokes about mine
whistle.
All the time. No, you sound great. How are
thank
you?
Thank you. I'm good. You smell good.
Oh, thank you. So okay. Do you.
All right. Well,
thank you for having me here.
Thank you for...
This is a pleasure. It's an honor.
I'm sorry. I'm ovulating right now. So.
Hey, it's all good. I love it. I love
looking
it.
You directly in the eyes a little.
It's all good.
Okay. All right. So I have a present for you. You ready?
Okay.
So the show, of course, is about giving flowers, figurative flowers, to the black legends who have contributed so much to the culture, but not just figurative flowers. You also get... Dun, dun, dun.
Oh my God, that is beautiful. Thank you so
You're
much.
You're welcome. I made them myself.
Really?
Nope.
I was about to say, because this is a really beautiful arrangement.
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Okay. Damn, I've never been presented with beautiful flowers like that before.
Really?
No, not by a beautiful woman, so you just made
what?
My day.
You know what?
No, I'm telling you.
You know what?
I'm telling you, that's the real.
I will cut this interview short. Okay, so... Middle school me is screaming internally right now.
Okay.
Cannot, like, stop or sit still because, okay, wait.
You're making me blush right now.
Listen.
That's really hard for a dark-skinned brother to blush.
You just needed the right one, that's all.
That's all I needed. And I got the right one sitting right here. You absolutely right. See, you messing with the wrong one. You can't flirt with me.
I see.
You cannot flirt with me because I'm about that life, for real.
Okay. All right. Take two.
Here
so,
we go.
13-year-old me is screaming internally right now.
Okay.
Because Love Ambition is still one of my favorite songs. And for our listeners, if you don't yet know who I'm talking to or about, it's Jason Weaver.
Jason Weaver's in the building. I'm here. Thank you for having me. This is really dope.
Thank you for agreeing to come say hey.
Oh, absolutely. No, this is great.
Okay. I'm going to behave is what I'm going to do.
Okay. But be yourself, though.
Well,
like,
then,
don't wear a mask. No, I want you to...
All right,
this is real. This is strong
right,
black
you're,
lead.
You're absolutely right.
We keep it real on this show. Well, I mean, we'll be professional, all that, but we gonna keep it real. We drinking bourbon.
Hell yeah.
We got that Maker's Mark.
Fuck yeah.
I got one little ice cube, and I got my rock. We good. Come on. Let's go.
Ah, all right. First question.
That's that one. What did Martin do?
When it hits right you in the back.
That's it right there. Yeah. Absolutely.
Okay, first question.
Yes.
Your skin is amazing.
Thank
What's
you.
The What is the routine? Is it like face masks? Like
water?
I hate y'all.
Water. I'll keep it real. Water, the elliptical machine, sweating, and really just trying to keep the stress down. And then I'll give credit where credit's due. My mother, she has beautiful skin.
Come
I kinda
on, genetics.
Inherited that.
Come through.
Yeah, you know. I mean, you know how it is. Black don't crack. Like,
right.
You know what I mean?
But we still spending all the money on, like, creams and
that's true.
All kind of stuff.
That's true. So. But a lot of the times for us, it'll just take some, what, vitamin D and some water. And I mean, you know, if we just got that kind of skin. We got that melanin. You know what I mean? Wakanda. Vibranium room.
Hey. Every time I ask a man what his skincare routine is, I always know that the answer is soap and water, and it makes me so mad.
That's all
like
it
all
is.
Of the dermatologists that I had to go to.
But see, we sweat a lot too.
I'm like, sweating right now. You just can't see it under the makeup.
Oh, okay. No, we sweat a lot. And then with me, like I run, do a lot of cardio stuff, and then I'll go into like the steam room and the sauna. Because after working out, it helps me to relax and kind of decompress. I'll meditate in there.
Mm.
I'll drink some water while I'm in there. And it just helps to, you know, purify the body, the skin, the whole nine. And that's important, like, at my age. Because I'm 39. I'm about to be 40.
What?
In July. So I'm at that point in my life where I'm very conscious now of what I'm putting into my body and what I'm doing to keep myself going. So
that's inspiring. I hope I reach that point one day.
I mean, I slip up, though. I'm an In-N-Out Burger King, so you know what I mean? It's not like I'm getting it all the way right. I'm not doing the vegan thing yet. No. Like, I'll still pull up to a barbecue spot and order slab of ribs.
Keto diet or whatever they call it.
Yeah, I don't do any of that. No. I still need my collard greens with my turkey necks in them. I still need my mac and cheese. Mm-hmm. I need my fried chicken and baked chicken sometimes with my dressing.
No, sometimes at the same time.
Sometimes at the same time.
You know, that's how it is.
Absolutely.
So, earlier you mentioned that you're from Chicago.
Yes, ma'am.
And you made a new best friend who is also from Chicago.
Yeah, Kevin.
It was adorable to watch.
Yeah, Kevin, who I guess he's here, part of the production at Strong Black Lee. He's from Calumet City.
Mm-hmm. And it seems like it's rare to find somebody from.
It's very rare because people that live or that grew up like in the south suburbs and the outskirts of Chicago, my family's originally from the south side. Mm-hmm. From 71st in Michigan. Shout out the Haywood family, 71st in Michigan, South Side Chicago, right off the damn Rhine. If you know, you know. but with me, I grew up in like the Dalton, Calumet City, South Holland area.
Okay.
And back then, you know, it's just like regular middle class. My family was like one of the first black families to move into that area.
What was that like?
That was really different. To be honest with you, because I was so young, I didn't realize the significance of it at the time. Mm-hmm. But my mother, shout out to my mother, Kitty Haywood.
Hey, Mama.
She was a successful jingle singer in Chicago. And she also had a...
she's a jingle singer?
Yeah, she was a jingle singer for many years. And she made a lot of good money doing that.
That's one of my dream jobs.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I write jingles for everything.
Really?
Would you like me to write one now?
Yeah, sure.
Hanging out with Jason Weaver, having a great time. Bing.
That's it.
Pow, where's my
That's
money?
A successful jingle right there. I could see that happening already.
I mean, when we gonna hit the studio then?
Like, you know what? I'm gonna link you with my mom because she heavy in that world. Like, no, and honestly, that's what she did for so many years. And that's what provided her the means by which she could move us out of the South Side and give me a great... you know, home to be raised in and great schools that I went to out there. Shout out to Thornwood High School, T-Birds. What's happening? Y'all know what it is. I'm here. Jason Weaver's here representing for the Shy, representing for Thornwood.
I love it.
So now, so when Kevin said that, he was like, oh, yeah, I'm Calumet City. I was like, what the hell? I never hear anybody say they from Calumet City. I
feel like it was a setup.
No, I was just blown away by that. So shout out to Kevin. That was awesome.
I just like to watch men make friends, I guess. I don't know. Yeah, I was moved. Yeah. I was so moved.
And then to be out here in Los Angeles and to meet somebody from the same area, that's
small
crazy.
Small world.
Small world.
Large world, but still so small.
Yep.
So in my head, I know this is not true and it's ridiculous, but in my head, your childhood was exactly like Simba's childhood.
Okay. Okay. How's that?
Well, you know, you did the voice for Simba.
Yeah, I was the singing voice for Simba.
And so you are the same person now.
Okay.
I'm sorry about the stampede. It must have been.
It was traumatic.
Yeah.
But,
yeah.
You know, we made it through. Especially when the check came. When Disney sent the check, I was like, never mind the stampede.
What was that? How old were you when that happened? And then what was it like to get your first, like, the first big check? What would it feel like?
It was amazing. First and foremost, thank you so much to Sir Elton John. He was the one that recruited me.
Wow.
For that project. And it came about through Michael Jackson in the Jackson's miniseries. I know we'll get into that. But how I got that role was Sir Elton came to the set one day while we were performing. I think it was Who's Loving You. It was one of our performance scenes. And he had come through because he wanted to not only see what we were doing, but he wanted to come and show support to Michael or whatever. And just see what was happening. Just that particular day, I happened to be performing live and he heard my voice. And he approached my mother after somebody had made him aware of the fact that, you know, it was my mom on the set. And he said, you know, I think your son is great. I'm doing this thing for Disney, this new animated film called The Lion King. And I don't know, is he interested in doing something like that? So, of course, my mother was like, well, if he's not interested, he gonna figure it out. And so make a long story short, after we wrapped the Jackson's miniseries, Disney brought me into the studio somewhere out there in Burbank. They showed me some storyboard sketches of Simba and the Lion King. One of them actually happened to be the stampede scene.
See?
So I saw part of that storyboard and they showed me, you know, some basic stuff that they were working on at the time. And then they asked me to just go in and sing this song. And I had had a day to kind of learn it. Mm-hmm. But working with them in the studio that day, they helped me put the personality into it. And by the time I got done, everybody was sold on the fact that, you know, I could sing the songs, and they mm-hmm. wanted to roll with me. Because I think there were two other young kids who were auditioning at the same time as I was. Mm-hmm. But, you know, the stars just aligned, and the Lord decided to bless me with it.
Amen.
And, so I was given that. I was blessed with that opportunity, and mm-hmm. it's been actually one of the more rewarding experiences of my life and my career.
Yeah.
It really has been, because I either get... When I'm in the street and people approach me, I either get called Michael Jackson or Simba or Teddy, or I never get called by my name. So, but shout out to Sir Elton, to Tim Rice, to mm-hmm. Disney. Thank you guys so much. And to all the people, including yourself, that supported it, because it wouldn't have been as successful as it was had it not been for the people being behind it. Uh-huh. So thank you. Appreciate it.
I'm so glad that I could do something for you.
I just
want to make the world a better place.
Oh, no, you definitely are. You're making my world a better place.
Well, listen. All right.
Okay. Yeah. I told you.
I know. I'm not usually bested when it comes to flirting, but I just...
Really?
You win, I think. I'm winning
right now.
Damn it. I'm going to try again. I'm going to bounce back.
All good.
But my favorite song from the soundtrack was I Just Can't Wait to Be King. And awesome. I would always sing Zazu's part for some reason.
Okay.
I don't know why. Okay. And I just wanted you to know that.
It was a fun part.
Yeah, but I've never seen a king or a beast with quite so little.
Yeah, that's fun. Yeah. That's fun to say and to sing. That whole song is fun. Like, it trips me out. I'll have grown men like that look rough and tough, and you know, they seem like they on some thugs.
Gonna be a mighty
word. They know it, or they tell me, like, hey, dog. Man, the Lion King, though, dog. That's one of my favorite
she
movies
my
you
heart,
ever did.
Man,
it touched my
she
heart,
touched
dog,
my heart,
man.
For real.
That shit fire. I be like, hey, gangsta, man. You know what I'm saying? But it's cool, though, because, I mean, it transcends. You uh-huh. know what I'm saying? That particular project. I mean, man, I'll have soccer moms coming up to me. I'll have little mm-hmm. kids from the suburbs. And then I'll have the hood showing love on some genuine shit. So, I think it's awesome. It's just a major blessing. Mm-hmm. Major blessing.
Are you involved at all with the... the live action one that they're doing?
No. because first and foremost, my voice, it may not sound like it, my speaking voice, mm-hmm. but my voice changed tremendously from that time that I sang the original songs mm-hmm. up until now. Because they even, when they put Disney on Broadway, mm-hmm. Disney had reached out to me. I mean, they've always been very supportive. Wow. Anything that they're doing with the Lion King or with that property, mm-hmm. they always try to include me in on things.
That's
but it's
a good
like,
plug to have.
Yeah, yeah. No, I've been working for Disney for years, so uh-huh. they've always been a pleasure to work with. But my voice changed and mm-hmm. it just matured and
Can we hear what it sounds like now?
It'll sound horrible, and I'm not gonna play myself on Strong Black Lee, and I'm definitely not gonna play myself in front of you.
It's just me and you here, though. Like, no, it's
it ain't just me and
we
you.
We family.
We are family, but you ain't finna have me out here playing myself, trying to reach notes I can no longer hit.
I mean, I didn't ask you to sing something like it. You can sing whatever you want. You can sing the ABCs. I just want to hear what the voice sounds like now that you're a grown-ass man.
All right, well, let me drink some more bourbon with you, okay. And we'll figure it out.
All right.
How about that?
All right. And if I will do the same, and maybe we can duet.
Yeah, maybe we can.
What's the name? Donny Hathaway and Roberta Flack.
That'll work.
That's what we'll do.
Marvin, okay. Tammy Terrell.
Mm. Mm.
It's Diana Ross, Marvin.
Yes.
Yes. A lot of combos. We could figure it out.
Let's just sing for the rest of the interview.
Okay, we can try to do that, but it'll be a short one because my voice, mm-hmm. I haven't worked out in a couple weeks of my voice, so I'll get tired.
I've never worked out, so.
Oh, no?
Not on purpose.
I feel you.
Okay. All right, let me focus. This is my problem in the last interview. Like, I just get to talk and I forget about all the questions.
We're having fun. Isn't that what this is all about?
I mean, yeah. So, Mr. Weaver,
yes.
I feel like most people's introduction to you was a very small part in a very small movie called The Jacksons and American Dream.
Mm-hmm.
How the hell did that happen?
First of all, me coming from Chicago, this was like, what, the early 90s? Mm-hmm. So most of the time when big roles were put up like that, like playing Michael Jackson, whatever, they would automatically audition kids from here in Los Angeles or New York first.
Mm-hmm.
So kids on either side of the coast had a chance at the role prior to us that were in Chicago or any
the
other
poor flyover states.
Yeah, no, mm-hmm. definitely. And especially during that time as it related to actors, and especially black actors, we were always kind of overlooked. But it just so happened at the time, I had a really great talent agent that was based in Chicago. Shout out to Ann and Geddes, and Elizabeth Geddes. And they got me an audition. So me and my mother, and I'll never forget, we rehearsed and we practiced those songs and the dance moves and any and everything that my mother knew about the Jackson 5 and Michael Jackson. She showed me and taught me, and we spent 2 weeks in the kitchen of our home just going over the material, singing the songs, doing the dance moves. And that was just to prepare for the tape audition.
Yeah. Oh, it sounds so stressful.
So we went down to, you know, downtown Chicago. I put put a tape down, a taped audition down in my agent's office. Sent it out here. They sent it out here to L.A. Casting liked it. They wanted me to do another tape. So I did that. And upon them reviewing that, then they were like, okay, this kid's kind of serious. Because there were thousands of kids.
That's insane.
Auditioning for this role. And I mean, understandably so. I mean, it's Michael Jackson, iconic figure. That was every kid's dream, was to play Michael Jackson. So eventually casting called back. And they said, you know, we're interested in flying him out to L.A. And
you got flued out.
I got flued out. And that was one of my first times that I came out to California. And then that's when it became kind of nerve-wracking, because that's when I began, when it began to register to me that this was like, it was real. It was happening. I was getting closer and closer.
It wasn't nerve-wracking before, though?
Like, nah, because I had been auditioning before. And I mean, even now, I don't get nervous at auditions. Like, and I don't get nervous when I'm on set, because I mean, this is what God, this is what he gave me. You know what I'm saying? So when the lights come on and when they say go, I just do what's naturally inside of me, what I've naturally been given. So no, I don't ever go on set feeling intimidated, or I don't ever go into an audition feeling intimidated or feeling like it can't be done or that it's not mine. I go into every situation in life and in business like I own it, because if you don't do that, you won't win. Like, you won't make it in this business if you don't embrace and exude a certain level of confidence that lets people know in the room that you about that life.
Right.
So if you walking around and you nervous and you afraid to turn up when it's time to turn up, you're just not going to do it. Now, that doesn't mean you have to be arrogant. I'm talking about confidence, not arrogance. So, you know, fortunately for me, I was blessed with that. And when I eventually came out here and was given the opportunity to audition in front of casting, I did that first, the casting director. Then audition in front of the director, Miss Karen Arthur. She liked me. And then eventually they said, okay, we want you to audition in front of the Jackson family. Now, I've been here. They flew me out and they put me and my mother up for like 2 or 3 days. So the third day was like the last day that we were going to be in Los Angeles. I was scheduled to audition in front of the family. And then I was going to be flown back to Chicago on a red eye.
Oh, gosh.
So this is what happened. Here's the real deal. This is how it really popped off.
All right, give us the tea.
So I came to the audition. It was at the ABC Center. This is when ABC, the network, was headquartered in Century City. In these two towers that they have, like right there off of Avenue of the Stars.
You have a great memory.
Oh, no, I really, my mind, it just works like that.
Amazing.
So I'll never forget, I was sitting in a room and they were like, there had to have been around 50 kids with their parents in this one room. And everybody had their side. Some people were, some kids were auditioning for Jackie, some for Tito, some for Randy. So me and my mom, we get there after taking a cab from the hotel to the spot where we were auditioning. And the casting, or the assistant to the casting director, because there was so much going on, she was hectic. And she was just giving out sides to random kids. So when I went up to get mine, she gave me the Randy sides. So I'm looking and I'm like, Randy, Randy. And I knew it was, you know, kind of a small role or whatever. And
is Randy the one that falls during the practice scene?
No, that was Marlon.
Marlon.
I mean, Randy is like their youngest brother. Who got down with the Jackson 5 much later on, like when they went to Vegas and did their review there. But he wasn't part of like the original five that were like, you know, the iconic group that they're known as being.
Okay, history lesson.
Yeah, so
happy Black History Month, y'all.
Right? So they gave me the size for that, and I'll never forget. I was like, I didn't come out here to play Randy. Mm. No offense to Randy Jackson, by the way. Randy, you know Jackson, I love, we love you. Yeah, because I met him later on when I became older, and he's a hella cool guy. Uh-huh. I love Randy. But when I saw the sides, I was like, man, mm-mm. I didn't come all the way out from Chicago to audition for Randy. Like, I came out here to play Michael. Mm. Like, but I didn't want to ruffle any feathers, so right. I just kind of waited. Then I sat around, and then as I was waiting to go into my audition, this kid walked out mm-hmm. who had auditioned for Michael. And I guess he had a horrible audition because he came out and he slammed his sides into the garbage pail next to me.
Oh, no.
So I happened to look in the garbage pail and I saw that it said Michael 2. That's what the character's name was.
Uh-huh.
And so I was like, oh, those are the Michael sides. That's. So I picked them up out of the garbage and I began to review them. I was already kind of familiar with the material, mm-hmm. but I began to really review them and re-familiarize myself with the material. And then eventually, the casting assistant comes back out and she says, Jason Weaver from Randy? I was like, oh no, I'm auditioning for Michael. They just had it wrong.
Oh,
and she was like, oh, okay, flick. Cool, come on in. So this is when it got real. Now this is when I did get nervous, palm sweating the whole nine. The room was like,
mom spaghetti, all that.
Yeah, it was ill. I walk into this room, it's like lit. Like, I mean, lit up, because they had damn near cameras like this in there so they could capture the moment. Mm-hmm. So I walk in there, it's like mad lights, and the Jackson family is sitting in these seats. It was almost like a mini auditorium, so to speak. Ugh. So the first people I see is Mrs. Jackson. I see Joe Jackson. I see Jermaine. I see his wife at the time, Margaret Maldonado.
Wow.
Amazing. I see the director. I see the producer, one of the producers, Suzanne DePass. Shout out to Suzanne DePass. She was there. And so that's when I was like, oh, this shit is real. Mm. Like, okay, I'm looking at Joe Jackson. Joe Jackson's looking at me. I'm looking at him. He's looking at me. So I'm like, damn, there go Joe. There go Joe. Oh, shit, there go Joe.
I can't fuck this up.
I do not want my ass beat. Okay. Much respect to Joe. Rest in peace. No, that's real talk. I was scared to death.
I understand.
But here's what was so funny. At that time, he and I were like damn near the same height. This whole time, I'm thinking Joe Jackson, like this big diesel, you know what I mean?
Yeah, he was.
He was a small guy, mm-hmm. but you could tell he had it with him.
Yeah, short people are very angry. I know.
I guess, yeah. So, you know, Mrs. Jackson, she smiled at me. And when she smiled at me, that's what helped me relax, because I felt like she was the one in the room that recognized that we were all kids.
Yeah.
Coming in there, you know what I'm saying? And everybody was nervous, and I guess she could sense that. So I guess her thing was to try to reassure the kids that were coming in there and make them feel comfortable that there was somebody safe in the room.
Aww.
And that's what Mrs. Jackson did for me. And once she gave me that smile,
it was it.
I was like, oh, I can do this.
Aww.
They're people. They're normal. And then the music started, and so I sang the songs. So I'll never forget Mrs. Jackson whispered something into Joe's ear, and he shook his head like... And I was like, oh, shit.
Oh, my God. Like, so you saw that while you were performing?
Yeah. No, oh they. I mean, they were very, and usually it's not like that in an audition. They were very transparent as far as whether they approved or disapproved or whatever, which for me as an actor, I thought that was great, because that helped me gauge what I was doing and where I should go. Because sometimes as an actor, you can overplay in the room if you are overconfident. Mm-hmm. So when I got that little bit of reassurance from them that they dug where I was at, because I kept it in a happy medium.
Yeah.
I was like, okay, this is where I need to stay. This is my sweet spot. Mm-hmm. So when we began to run the dialogue, it just kind of flowed. And when I eventually walked out of the room, I knew something was up, because the casting assistant was like, so you guys are scheduled to go back to Chicago on the red eye tonight? So my mom was like, yeah, why? She's like, well, hold on. She said, somebody's going to call the hotel, and, you know, we're going to see, you know, what's going on after this. We have more kids that we have to audition, but we'll call you guys later on. So me and my mom were like in the hotel room. We just saw pins and needles. And then we did get a call from casting, and we're like, okay, well, look, Jason did great. You know, we love what he did in the room. You guys are scheduled to go back to Chicago. Mm-hmm. You guys catch your flight, da 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 da. And, you know, if anything goes further, we'll call you.
Oh my gosh.
I get on a flight. I go back to Chicago. I go to school the next morning. So cats at school was like, oh, you back home, Joe? Man, I thought you was going to play Michael Jackson. I thought you was on your Hollywood. What happened, dog? So I'm like, man, I did the audition, man. I don't know. They sent me home. Like, I may not get it, whatever, whatever. But unbeknownst to me at the time, what they had to do was get Michael's final approval for whoever played him. So the kids that auditioned that day and that they had put on tape, they sent those tapes out to Michael, who was out in Europe at the time rehearsing for the Dangerous Tour.
Wow.
And, man, we waited. I kid you not. I waited 3 months. 3 months to hear back from Michael because he was so focused on what he was doing. And then
Dangerous was huge.
Yeah, Dangerous is huge. Yeah, this is when Michael Jackson was still like, you know what I mean?
People passing out.
Yeah, it was ill. Mm-hmm. So one day, I'll never forget, I was coming home from school. I was on the bus, and I got off the bus, and literally my bus stop was directly across the street from my house. Mm-hmm. So I'll never forget, I got off the bus, and my mom ran outside, and she was like, Jason, you got it! And I was like, I got what, an F? I was like, did my report card show up or something? I was like, I know she not happy about that. I know she not happy about it, because I know what I'm getting. But she was like, no, Jason, Michael, he loves you. You're going to play Michael Jackson.
You were handpicked by Michael Jackson.
Handpicked by Michael Jackson. Holy shit. And I shit you not, I got on my bike and I went up and down the block. I knocked on everybody's door, even people that didn't know us. I was like, y'all playing Michael Jackson? I had old people looking at me like,
now what? Say something.
Exactly. Went back to school the next day. Because I told my best friend, Alfred, who lived down the street from me, I was like, man, I got the role. I was like, tomorrow, we're going to pull up. I'm telling the whole school I'm playing Michael Jackson. So he's like, man, ain't nobody going to believe you. Make a long story short, went to school, told everybody, told all my teachers. And then people really didn't believe it until I started getting my books from school, my assignments lined up that my teachers had, you know, worked out because they knew I was going to be gone for a couple months.
Uh-huh.
And then, like, kids were seeing, they was like, man, you getting all your assignments? Where you going? I'm like, man, I told your ass I'm finna play Michael Jackson.
Yeah, have
and that's what I did. Yeah, bye. Went to Pittsburgh, and I guess you know the rest is history. After that,
that was
and that's the real that's story. The real story. Oh my god, that's how it really went down.
It was moving. I laughed. I cried. I was nervous, and then at the end, I got the part. I got the part.
Yeah, no, it was so something. Awesome. We all know as people of color how it is in this business and how important it is to help each other and to reach back and to give others an opportunity where they can have their chance and display their talent.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, the Jackson family at that time were such on a level, it's like you wouldn't think that they would look back to, you know.
Because they didn't have to.
They really didn't have to. But if you saw all of those kids that were in that miniseries were relatively unknown talent, you know what I'm saying? Like, with the exception of maybe like Angela Bassett, Lawrence Hilton Jacobs, even Terrence Howard wasn't even a name back then. Like, and he played Jackie. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Like, we were all given an extraordinary opportunity from the Jackson family that afforded a lot of us a springboard by which we could really establish a career.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, excuse me.
It's okay.
I really want people to know that. Because we're in an age now and we're at a time, especially as Black people involved in Hollywood, where we're very progressive. We're all about pushing the ball up the field. We're helping one another. Mm-hmm. But there were people prior to this latest movement that's going on now, like the Jackson family, who gave people a shot. Suzanne DePass. Mm. A lot of people don't know about Suzanne DePass. But if you're Black and if you're an executive, you need to know who Suzanne DePass is.
Mm.
Suzanne DePass was a former executive assistant for Berry Gordy.
Oh, wow.
During the Motown era. She was the one that actually discovered the Jackson 5. That's who Vanessa Williams played in the miniseries. Suzanne DePass has kicked down a lot of doors for young Black men and women, not only in front of the camera, but behind the camera.
Hmm.
The reason why we had a Smart Guy, the reason why we had a Sister-Sister, the reason why we had a Jackson miniseries, the reason why we had a Lonesome Dove in series like that is because of Suzanne DePass.
Shout
out to Suzanne DePass. She had been very instrumental in helping me to establish my career and somebody that I have a tremendous amount of respect for.
Mm. Come through Black History Month trivia. Yeah. I love it.
No, this is real. And they need to know. Yeah. Like, you know, your audience, they need to know who these people are that paved the way for myself and for the new generation.
Yeah.
Because those are the people, hence Strong Black Lead, what the show is about.
Mm-hmm.
It's about raising awareness and focusing on the spotlight on those people who have really had a major impact in what we do and us having a position here in this town and in this industry.
I feel like you're interviewing yourself, and this is like the best time. I'm just sitting back.
I just want to get it all out because first and foremost, like what this show is about, I really, really respect, and I want those aspiring actors, artists, musicians, executives who are trying to get into this business. I want to give them the real and where it comes from so that they know when they get here and when they continue to move forward in their careers, they know who are the ones to look at and thank later on when they see them in person.
Yeah.
Or shake their hand when they see them in person. Or to just go back and study some of their work and see some of the things that they've done in their professional and personal life that's gotten them this far.
Mm-hmm.
It's important for us to have those figures that we look back at
right.
and say, and aspire to be like and say, hey, now I want to push it up and take it to another level from where they did it. That's what it's all about.
Yeah.
If you're not carrying that kind of mindset as a young black professional in this business, then you don't need to be in the game.
What is something that you wish you had known then, like when you first started?
That's a really good question.
Thanks, I'm a professional.
No, you are. It's a great question. You know what? I have no regrets. And I have nothing that I look back on and I say I wish that would happen, because everything that's happened in my life and in my career was what was meant to happen. And it either helped me grow as a professional or it helped me grow as a man. So I don't look back at certain points in my life or things in my career and say, man, I wish I would have known this at this time. No, because everything happens at the time that it's supposed to. I'm a firm believer in that. So
have you always been?
No, I grew into that. I grew into that as far as my spirituality. When I was younger, I didn't get that. But I began to recognize as I got older just how real that is. Like, you're not going to be blessed with something until you're ready to receive the blessing. Just because you have the talent at that particular time, or just because you have the will and the desire at that particular time, doesn't necessarily mean that you're prepared for when that blessing comes. So for me, there have been certain stages in my career where when the blessing has come, I've been ready for it. Otherwise, I could have squandered it off, or I could have messed it up to where more blessings wouldn't have come after that.
Right.
So, nah, I mean, even in the mistakes or even at times where I felt like, oh, man, I could have done this better, or I could have did that or did that, it'll be shown to me in some kind of way later on. Nah, that was meant to happen. Wow. So that you could be ready for this. So
the emotional maturity is just suffocating. Like, I'm working on it. Me and my therapist, we in it. We in it. And you just, I love it.
It's good though, because everybody has a different, everybody has a different path and a different journey. And everybody has a different way of coming into that understanding. Just because that's the way I came into it doesn't necessarily mean that's the way that you're going to come into it. But eventually, if you keep going, you'll come into it. Like, if you really have that faith, and if you really believe, like, whether you believe in God or whatever, you believe in universal law, whatever the case may be. If you believe in yourself and you believe in where you're going and where you feel you're destined to go, you'll eventually get there. And it, you know, the emotional maturity just comes from learning from those experiences, and whether you internalize them positively or negatively. When I go through something, I try to look at it from the silver lining standpoint. Okay. That didn't work. That didn't work out the way I wanted to. But you know what? Something's going to come from that.
That's amazing.
And usually when I think like that, it always does. And it'll be something even better.
Yeah.
You feel me? So that's how I like to live my life.
One of my favorite things to do is to reflect on how black TV used to be in the 90s.
Yeah.
Like between, like, there was a show called Homeboys in Outer Space. Like,
I remember that.
I know. But like that something like that happens, you know, somebody's like, yeah, let's put some money on this weird idea y'all got. I loved Thea.
Thank you.
Absolutely loved Thea. What I remember most from Thea, for some reason, I think Brandy played the sister, right?
Yeah. Shout out to Brandy.
And I think there was this isn't important or interesting at all, but I feel like there was a moment where she's like outside singing for some reason.
No, we did on the show, it was an episode where we were celebrating Thea, our mother, on the show. We were celebrating her birthday. And we did, me and Brandy, well, the kids, we did a Motown review medley thing.
Oh, my gosh.
And I sang, and Brandy sang, and that was the scene. But that was before Brandy became the international pop star. That was before I Want to Be Down and all of that. So, man, when she sang on that episode, it just blew people away. But I knew it was coming.
Yeah.
Because Brandy would be on the set just singing her ass off.
Those runs.
Every day. No, I'm talking about just walking from the dressing room to the set.
She was singing. I mean, I would too if I sounded like Brandy. Oh, man. You couldn't get me to shut up.
It was just incredible. And I knew it then. I was like, man, Brandy about to be up out of here. Like, I don't even know why she's doing the show. You know what I mean? Like,
Did you not feel that way about yourself?
I've never felt that way about myself. Like, I've always, like, I've carried my career and the things that I do, like, it's a blessing. I'm happy to be here. You know what I mean? Like, I'm a kid from Chicago. Humble. Yeah, like, I know where I could be. Yeah. Like, I come from a city where not a lot of us make it out. Mm. So when I'm on a set and when I'm doing stuff like this, I recognize a blessing instantly, and I don't ever look a gift horse in the mouth. Mm. When I'm on set and when I'm doing something, like, I thank God for it, and I let it be known that I'm thankful. You know what I mean? Yeah. Because I want him to know that I'm appreciative. You feel me? Not to talk all spiritual and religious and all that, that's real shit for me. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? So, I've never carried myself like that. But I've definitely recognized people that I've worked with in the past and been able to point out and say, you know, this person's exceptional. Yeah. And, you know,
I've never auditioned for anything in my life. Because I'm just like, it's not my particular calling. Okay. It's not my ministry. But I'm just trying to imagine being a kid and being around, being incredibly talented, but also being around so many other incredibly talented youngsters. Mm-hmm. What was that like? Like, were you ever, like, shook by the competition? Did you ever feel like, you know...
Never.
Wasn't stressful?
Nope.
How were you such a chill child?
Because it was what I wanted to do.
Uh-huh.
I couldn't imagine myself doing anything else. I've been in this business over, 32 years? Mm. Maybe even longer. Maybe like 33 or 34 at this point. But I knew that this is what I was put on earth to do. Mm-hmm. I knew it from the first time I watched, like, my first episode of The Cosby Show. Mm. And I saw Malcolm Jamal Warner and Lisa Bonet and Keisha Knight Pulliam. And I said to myself, I can do that.
Yeah.
Like, I can do that, and I can do it really well. And that was before my first audition. I just knew something inside of me told me that that's what my calling was.
Amazing.
So when I eventually got the opportunity to begin auditioning for stuff, it felt like riding a bike. Wow. It didn't feel awkward, and I always felt like I've always had a Mamba mentality, like Kobe. Mm-hmm. Like, okay, Kobe has this thing called Mamba mentality, where it's like Kobe snaps into his zone where he feels nothing can get in his way, and there's no one better than him, that he is the man, and at that hour when he is called to do his thing, he is ready, willing, and able to do it and will execute to a T.
Like, Beyonce turned into Sasha Fierce.
Exactly. And I mean, that's the kind of mentality I've always embraced since the very beginning when I first started my career, so... Anytime I've gone into an audition, I don't care if the guy sitting in front of me or next to me waiting to go in is a more experienced actor who has more of a name. Mm-hmm. I came here to win.
Right.
Worry about me. Mm-hmm. I know who you are.
Yes.
You may not know who I am, but by the time you leave here, you're going to know. Mm. And that's the whole mentality that I took on early on in my career and that I still embrace to a degree to this day. I don't have the same killer instinct because... I'm at a point in my career now where I'm just trying to continue to follow along with good work and stuff that. And I've, due to my resume and my track record, people give me the opportunity to express myself more creatively and allow me more of that kind of freedom. But before people were familiar with my talent and who I was, like, the killer instinct was real. Mm-hmm. Like, there was nobody that could stand in my way. There was nothing that was going to stop me. And nah, I've never been nervous. Mm-hmm. Never been nervous.
Wow, what a sentence.
Never been nervous.
What a sentence to be able to say. My goodness.
No, that's real.
No, I'm envious. I'm inspired. It must be nice. You mentioned The Cosby Show a little bit ago. Was that like the first time or one of the first times that you felt like you saw yourself represented?
Absolutely.
Yeah,
in pop culture? Absolutely. Mm. I think, let me think now. It was like that. The only things that we had in that era as kids where we were being represented in mainstream America and the media, it was like Michael Jackson, The Cosby Show, maybe Prince.
Prince?
Fat Albert in the Junkyard Gang or whatever they were called. Like, those kind of images were the only ones back then in the 80s that we had as black kids.
Yeah.
to look at and say, oh, we're part of that, because we weren't being shown on MTV like that. We weren't really in a lot of the classic 80s movies like the John Hughes films and all of that that are, you know, considered to be and are iconic.
Yeah.
We weren't featured in any of those. This was prior to even Denzel Washington coming to the forefront. This is when Denzel Washington was like on the show Saint Elsewhere.
I remember Saint Elsewhere.
You know what I mean? There weren't a lot of us that were being represented, but I always felt that there was a place for us.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, that was, again, due to Suzanne DePass. Like, she was the one that made that happen. She was the one that put the Maury family on TV.
Mm.
That was her that did that. That was her that orchestrated that play. You know what I mean? That's why it was so important for me to shout her out so people could know even her contribution to the culture and to TV, mainstream television. It's significant.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Can we talk about the episode of Smart Guy where you took Beyoncé to prom?
Okay.
Oh my God, you touched Beyoncé.
Yeah.
Ah!
Hella cool.
That's my question. I don't know.
Shout out to B. Yeah, I met Beyoncé and Destiny's Child when they first had broken out with their hit, the Okay.
When it's really yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So they were riding that wave. And I'll never forget, because I knew who the group was, and the producers of Smart Guy were like, hey, next episode, we're going to have this girls group on, and you guys know them, probably like Destiny's Child or something. I was like, hell yeah.
Do we know them?
Beyoncé coming? Because this before, shout out to Jay. No disrespect, Jay. No disrespect, Hov. I was a teenager. I didn't know. But I was like, oh my God, yeah, Beyoncé.
Oh my goodness.
Because I was like, oh man, she from Houston. She thick, she bad, blah, 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 blah.
Uh-huh.
So when she finally came to the set, I froze up. She was hella cool though. Like,
what?
She didn't make it an intimidating thing, but like Beyoncé was bad at 17, 18 years old.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that was the first time ever in my life as a dude that I was afraid to approach a chick and like holler. I kept it very professional. Like,
what? This suave man in front of me who has had me speechless several times.
I kept it very professional. Well, number one is because I was working for Disney at the time. Mm-hmm. So, you know, in a work setting, in a professional setting, that's with any woman that I encounter. I don't hit on women in the workplace and stuff.
Shout out to the Me Too movement.
Word. And I've been down with that since I was a kid. Like, right. I just don't do that. I don't think it's professional, you know, to carry on like that on set. So that was one of the main reasons why I never really got at her. And then just number two, it was like, she's Beyoncé, you know what I mean? And even the scenes that we did together, it was like, we do the scenes, we rehearse, and I'd be like, okay, I'm going to my dressing room. Because I was 2 seconds away from being like, yo, so I'm saying I'm trying to come to Houston with, plus I was always 2 seconds away, but I kept it.
See, now you see how I feel.
I guess. I mean, but I'm no Beyoncé. Like, you know what I mean? I appreciate
you
the
might
love.
You might be my Beyoncé.
All right now.
Hey.
All right
did
now.
Did I win that round? Am I back in it?
No, you back in it. Hey. We in the majors. We here.
So, you're an actor. You're a musician. You sing. And you got to do all of those things in Drumline.
Got to act in Drumline.
Yes.
Didn't get to sing in Drumline.
No, but I mean like the music.
Oh, the music part. Element.
So there was that. Mm-hmm. What was that like? Because I heard that the training that you had to go through was like nuts.
It was pretty intense. Mm-hmm. I didn't know prior to becoming a part of that film just how hard they trained first and foremost. And I didn't know how serious it was as far as the culture of being in a black HBCU marching band.
Mm-hmm.
It is a community all unto itself.
Mm-hmm.
It's its own fraternal order, so to speak, because what you're getting is a whole bunch of kids who are aspiring musicians. And not like athletes. These are kids that either want to play trombone or do the drums, whatever. But they carry that same level of intensity into what they do as an aspiring collegiate football player would be, or an aspiring pro football player would be.
It's their sport.
It's their sport.
Mm-hmm.
But it was an amazing experience. I hadn't had that much interaction with HBCUs growing up.
Mm-hmm.
With me growing up in Chicago. In the South, a lot of people are familiar with HBCUs and how they go and the traditions with the bands and the whole nine.
Mm-hmm.
Because a lot of that tradition is carried on down there.
Mm-hmm.
So when I got involved, I was learning a lot about our people and about the culture. And it was a great learning experience. I'm an honorary member of KK Psi, the band fraternity. They were gracious enough to accept me as an honorary member.
Aww, I didn't know that existed.
That's no, there are band fraternities that are for real, like, that are as serious as other Black Greek fraternities, like a Kappa Alpha Psi. It's no stepping. It's just more... It's just more like them taking pride, you know, in their letters and taking pride in the fact of being a band fraternity and being excellent musicians. It's more about that for them. Mm. I mean, you know, they have their colors and, you know, all of that stuff, but it's really all about the school that they went to, what they played, that kind of thing. So I learned a lot about that. We had spent a great deal of time, the whole shoot, on Clark Atlanta University's football field where we would rehearse. That was amazing, working with all those kids. Because a lot of the kids that were playing in the band were from Southwest DeKalb High School in Decatur, Georgia. So we had kids from Southwest DeKalb. We had kids from Clark Atlanta University. And then we had a few kids from FAMU. Because FAMU is... the best HBCU band, like, no disrespect to anybody else out
everybody
there.
Everybody listening, like, either
They're
screaming in agreement and screaming.
They're top tier. So much so, and this is a true story, they wanted FAMU to be the band that we went up against in a final scene.
Oh, like by name?
Yeah. Wow. And because at the end of the movie they lose to us. They were like, we opt out. And Morris Brown was gracious enough to come in and replace them and be willing to take the L in the movie. But I mean, they're a top tier HBCU band. So they weren't having it. But we had a lot of their drummers and a lot of, we had like some French horns and trombones and we had a few, we had them sprinkled in.
Yeah.
So that was dope. Working with Orlando Jones. He was awesome. Learned a lot from Orlando as a professional.
What is the most important thing you learned from him?
What I learned from Orlando on that particular film was the importance of actors interacting or offering their opinion as far as where they want their character to go and making the people around them, whether it's the director or the writer, to listen to their voice. If you feel like instinctually like you want to do something that may not be in the script, you have the right to share that idea as long as it's presented professionally and it makes sense for the script. You have that right to interject and provide some kind of creative contribution. And I'll be honest, me coming up in the game, I wasn't really one of those kind of actors. I kind of just did what I was told. And, you know, and did my thing and, and kept it moving. But Orlando, he not only instilled that in me, but he was teaching Nick Cannon that, Leonard Roberts, any of the young Black actors that was around. He always took the time to take us to the side and educate and enlighten us, whether it was helping us out as far as a scene, telling us we could make better choices as far as where we wanted to take the character, or even if it was just encouraging us after the film production, he would always tell me, Jason, you need to start writing. You need to start writing. You need to start producing. We need more of us writing and producing.
Come on, Orlando.
Cool? Orlando Jones, real dude.
I love it.
Real stand-up guy. He, Nick was already in the process of becoming that guy because Will Smith was kind of ushering him into the game. But he spent a lot of time with Nick, too, talking to him.
I'm sorry to cut you off.
No, it's no problem.
I love hearing stories of Black mentorship because I feel like... I can't tell if it's just something that I never think about or if it's something that, like, I never hear about. You know what I'm saying? But, like, just, like, the idea of, like, a bunch of Black actors just, like, helping out other Black actors. Like, it just makes me feel warm inside, you know?
No, it definitely happens.
Yeah.
It
is that something that you – that is important to you that you do for other people as well?
Absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, when I look back at my career and I think back as to the many – Black people that have helped me, especially Black actors, whether it was Angela Bassett, Lawrence Hilton Jacobs, Oprah Winfrey, well, the Jackson family, but that's a different thing. John Marshall Jones, who I worked with.
Wait, Oprah?
Yeah, I did. I was on the series, not the miniseries Brewster Place. I wasn't in the women of Brewster Place. ABC had a short-lived, hour-long drama series really? That they did called Brewster Place. And I was one of the series regulars in that.
I did not know that.
So I had the opportunity to work with Oprah on that when she had her studio, Harpo Studios, on the west side of Chicago. So she was someone who helped to mentor and gave, and she's another one that gave a lot of opportunities. I mean, to black people in the entertainment industry, and specifically in the city of Chicago. Mm-hmm. I want that to be known. Oprah did a lot for Chicago. She doesn't preach it a lot, or she doesn't thrust it out there a lot for the public to know. Mm-hmm. But Oprah's done a lot for black folks in Chicago.
Shout out to Oprah.
Shout out to Oprah. And then there are many other, Orlando Jones, who else? That's really all I can think of at the top of my head that really took the time to pull me to the side mm-hmm. and talk to me.
Yeah.
Oh, and Marlon Wayans. When I worked with Marlon Wayans on The Lady Killers, yeah. I had a small role in The Lady Killers. And I had the honor and the pleasure of working with Joel and Ethan Coen on mm-hmm. that film. And on one of the breaks, because all of my scenes were with Marlon. Mm-hmm. And one of the breaks, Marlon was telling me, he was like, yo, this is real cool. Because I was tripping on the fact I was working with the Coen brothers. Mm-hmm. He's like, yeah, this is great, man. But you know, you can do this too. Like, you can write your own movies. You can write your own shows. All you got to do is sit down in front of a computer and do it. And I'm trying to tell all y'all young black actors, man, and everybody, that's what we do in the Wayans family. That's how we keep working. Mm. He was giving
and
me that game.
With jobs.
Oh, yeah. That's because they create them.
Yeah, yes.
They create the opportunities for themselves mm-hmm. and for their friends. Mm-hmm. And he was giving me that game at a very early age. So mm-hmm. so shout out to Marlon Wayans. He's another real one.
He is. He also smells really good.
I'm sure. Well, I don't know about all that. I'm sure he does. He can afford to wear the best.
I find, me myself personally, speaking only for me, there are few like actors / musicians that I can like stand sort of.
Okay.
You know, I'm not gonna name no names, but sometimes it's just like, you know, you should do the other thing or do the other thing and not both things.
Okay.
Jamie Foxx is one that I love.
Yeah, Jamie's love. Shit. Yeah.
The other one is here. I don't know if you met him. His name is Jason Weaver.
All right.
How have the movies that you've made, like, especially the ones that sort of concern music, like Drumline and, mm-hmm. and ACL, how did those movies, making those movies, impact your music career, if they did at all?
Mm-hmm. That's another, man, you asked some great questions.
Thanks.
Actually, I'll be honest with you. How I got those roles was due to my musical career and do the relationships that I have in music based off of that.
Mm-hmm.
Dallas Austin, who was the executive producer of Drumline and mm-hmm. ATL.
I didn't know that.
Both of those movies uh-huh. were based on his experiences. As a kid, Dallas was in, as a drummer, in not a HBCU, but he went to high school in Columbus, Georgia, where he was uh-huh. one of the main snare drum guys. That's what inspired him to become a musician.
Wild.
ATL is based on this spot in Atlanta. It was a skating rink called Jelly Beans.
Mm.
Anybody from ATL, the old Atlanta, the real Atlanta, they know about Jelly Beans. Jelly Beans was the spot where Outkast used to come and hang out.
Oh my God.
That's where Dallas discovered TLC or developed a relationship with T-Boz.
Wow.
So that relationship where you see Tip and T-Boz.
Uh-huh.
Or Tip in a Lauren London, yeah, mm-hmm. that was Dallas and T-Boz.
Oh my God!
When he discovered they didn't have a romantic relationship or whatever, uh-huh. but that's how they became friends.
What?
Was through Jelly Bean because T-Boz was Nunu. T-Boz is actually one of the executive producers on ATL. This is their story.
What?
Yeah. So really, I mean, people, it's a cult classic. But what they're really watching, unbeknownst to them, is real Atlanta history.
Oh my God!
The founding fathers and the mothers of Atlanta. That's what ATL is. A lot of people don't know that. ATL was originally called Jelly Beans, but we had to change the name of the script because uh-huh. the people that owned Jelly Bean, I guess they wanted more money to license their name. But no, they opted not to do it. And so mm-hmm. I think 3/4 of the way through filming, mm-hmm. they told us that they were changing the name to ATL because of that. But that's what that story is. That's Atlanta history.
That's wild. Does Jelly Bean still exist?
No, it's gone. It's gone. Most of the clubs that created the sound and the feel of Atlanta, what it is now, like Club Nikki's, Club 559, All of those clubs are gone. Club Kaya. Mm-hmm. All of those clubs are gone now. Jazzy T's. I'm naming a lot of strip clubs. Pardon me, but that's what... No, but that's where the music came from.
I was about
from,
to say, it sounds like you stay in the clubs a lot.
I mean,
I know what kind of clubs you stay in.
No, when I was younger, because I'm 39 now, about to be 40. I'm a father of an 18-year-old boy. I mean, back in the day when I was in my teens and my 20s, yeah, that was my thing. They used to call me Georgia Power. I used to be in Magic City in Gentlemen's Club paying bills. And I come in there, they'd be like, there go Georgia Power. There he go. There go Bell South. Because I was making it rain before it became the thing. I had that Disney money.
I
was coming in there with that Disney money. Mm. I was coming in there with that Lion King check. Okay?
Like, turning up. Dance for Simba. Dance
Absolutely.
For Simba, girl.
Absolutely. But no, that's where those films came from. So when I did Drumline and ATL, is because I knew Dallas. Mm-hmm. And he was like, hey, man, I'm about to do these movies. Or I'm about to do this movie, Drumline. Why don't you come and audition? It wasn't handed to me. I should make that known. Mm. Nothing was ever handed to me. But my relationship with Dallas, it didn't hurt.
Right, sure.
I earned the role. And then from there on, he had told me on a set of Drumline that he was going to do Jelly Bean. Mm-hmm. And then I auditioned for that and was able to become a part of that production. So, yeah, that my music career and the relationship that I have with... music people in Atlanta has helped to some degree with my career, for sure.
Do you still talk to Chingy?
Yeah, as a matter of fact, I just spoke to Chingy 3 weeks ago because he asked me if I wanted to do a couple of appearances on the Millennium Tour that he's going to be doing with B2K.
Are you going to do it?
I'm going to come out in Atlanta. I'm going to probably do Chicago. I'm going to try to do out here in LA, and I'm going to do New York.
Oh, really?
But he called and he was gracious enough to reach out to me and ask me if I wanted to come and perform with him. Because we never got the chance to do that when the song was like at the forefront and when it was a hit. We never got the chance to put that together. So now we're getting the opportunity to do it and I look forward to it.
That's exciting.
Yeah.
My producer, Josh, is probably going wild.
Yeah, Josh is hella cool. He's cool.
He's like, oh, my God.
I like those little puns he came up with, too. Like, he's only one call away. Thanks, Josh. It's really creative. Him. That's the first time I've ever heard that.
Wow. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. So the song that we're talking about, by the way, is One Call Away. Mm-hmm. Is that the first time that you met Chingy? Like, how did that happen?
Oh, man. Okay, how that happened was, I had been living in Atlanta prior to that, maybe like five. No, I've been living in Atlanta for like 8 years prior. No, I'm sorry. Let me take that back. I've been living in Atlanta 4 years prior to us doing that record. Mm-hmm. And what happened was, is that Ludacris.
Luda.
And his co-host at the time on Hot 97, his name was Poon Daddy. And Lala, they all had a show on Hot 97 called Chris Lover Lover and Poon Daddy, and with Lala. And so Ludacris had blown up, did his thing with Disturbing the Peace, and I kept in contact with those guys because it's all Atlanta. Like, we all support each other, and especially when we see each other out of town.
Yeah,
you know, we always end up being together in some kind of way. Mm-hmm. So I was out here in LA. I was doing the Lady Killers. Mm-hmm. And I'll never forget, I had like a 6 a.m. call time. No. I had a 10 a.m. wardrobe fitting. Mm. And
your memory is impeccable.
No, because it's certain things that just, you know how it is. Certain things that stick in your mind and you just kind of remember. But I'll never forget, I had a 10 a.m. wardrobe fitting and Poon called me at like midnight at my hotel. He's like, boy, I hear you out here in L.A. What you doing? I was like, nothing, chilling. I was like, I got to get up in the morning and do this wardrobe fitting. Hey, dog, come to the studio. He was at Larrabee Studios West, which is right off of Santa Monica Boulevard. Mm-hmm. So he's like, man, come to the studio. I was staying at a hotel relatively in short distance to the studio. He said, man, I want you to hear this song, and I want you to meet this kid named Chingy. And I had heard of Chingy because he had the record out right there. Mm-hmm. And it was like booming out here in LA. Everywhere. It was like on 106. It was going ape shit. Mm-hmm. So I was like, yeah, I know who the kid is. He's like, man, I want you to come through and meet him. So I'm like, all right, whatever. So I went to the studio, met Chingy. We had played pool, hung out. And then Poon had pulled me to the side. And he was like, look, dog, the reason why I called you up here is because we got this record. And, man, I think your voice would be perfect for it, man. I think this would be like one that'll help you, you know what I'm saying, as far as your music career. So I was like, all right, cool. Like, what you want to do? He was like, well, check it out. Capitol, and this is keeping it all the way real. This is no diss to Motown, Capitol, or whatever. They were not checking for me for that song. As a matter of fact, they didn't even want me to be on it. They wanted Marcus Houston, or they wanted Houston, who was an artist that they had at the time, signed to Capitol, and or Marion. Because those were the guys that were hot. Mm-hmm. At that, you know what I'm saying? Yeah, like, respectfully speaking, those were the guys that were at the forefront as it related to young black performers. So they were, like, you know, the ones high on the priority list. Mm-hmm. And this was back in the day when actors weren't, if you could sing, you weren't really respected. Like, even if you could sing, it wasn't like how it is now, where you have, like, these triple threats, and that's, like, a normal thing. Like, back when I was doing it in the music business, it was kind of looked down upon for an actor to try to transition or was piggybacking back and forth. That was really looked down upon.
Yeah, it seems tough to do.
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. So they weren't really up for it, but Poon was like, man, F that, dog. He's like, man, I'm going to schedule the session, and I just want you to come in and just sing it, man. If they don't like it, they don't like it. If they do, cool. Mm-hmm. But, man, I want you to have this shot. Because I think you could kill it. So I was like, man, Poon, if they don't want me to do it, dog, then just leave it alone. He's like, no, I'm going to put the session together, man. Me and Chris want you to do it. So the following day, I did my wardrobe fitting. And then the next day, I was scheduled to be on set at 6 a.m. So Poon had called me that night before I was scheduled. He was like, look, I got a studio session, but I know you out here shooting. Give me a time that works for you. I didn't know a time that would work, because when you on set, you know what I'm saying, you're at the mercy of the production. So it just so happened that when I was working, and it was crazy because I asked Ethan Cohen, of all people, I should have asked the first day AD, but I asked Ethan Cohen. I was like, you know when we going to break for lunch? He was like, oh, Jason, we should be breaking in the next 45 minutes. Why? What's up? I was like, well, I got to call this guy. I was like, I got this recording session that I could probably do real quick, because we were shooting in Glendale. And we recorded the session at Enterprise Studios in Burbank off of Magnolia. Mm-hmm. So I was like, okay, well, I think I can get over to this session. Ethan and Joel, they were gracious, and I'll never forget this. And I thank them so much for doing it. Ethan was like, go and do your session. If you run a little late, we'll shoot around you. We'll get some inserts. I mean, this is like a Coen brother making an exception for me, and I'm nobody. Mm. So I was like, okay, cool. So I shoot over to Burbank. I go to the studio, and I sing the song down maybe like 5 or 6 times. Mm-hmm. Poon was like, man, that's the shit. We good. Going back to work. We gonna comp the vocal. When we get the vocal comp, we'll shoot you a copy of the song, whatever, so you can hear it. But, man, I think this shit jamming, man. If Capitol don't like it, we just gonna fight for it. And then, so we did the song and comp the vocals, and then maybe a week later, Poon called me and was like, dog, told you that shit was undeniable.
What?
And I think they did, because they still were skeptical about me being a part of it. So they did these focus groups.
Dang!
Yeah, they put together focus groups. They were really hating on me.
I
was insulted, but at the same time, I recognized and I understood, like, this is a business. Mm-hmm. And when it comes to that, I'm not emotionally attached. Like, I recognize as business people what they feel they have to do in order for them to reach their goal.
Yeah, like,
and
you can't take it personally.
Yeah, like, they weren't looking at it from an artistic standpoint. They were just trying to, you know,
make the most money.
Yeah. Mm-hmm, so, make a long story short, they did the focus groups, and out of all the focus groups, my version was the one that was picked.
Hey.
So they decided to run with it, and you know, after that, the song became really successful. I had to, and it's just keeping it real, I had to fight for my credit. They weren't even really trying to give me my credit. Like,
what?
Nah, when the video, this is real talk. When the video first premiered on BET, it just said, Chingy, one call away. I had to raise hell.
I will beat somebody's ass.
No, I had to raise hell to get featuring Jason Weaver. Like,
why? Like, what was?
I don't know.
Like, that doesn't make a piece of sense.
Nah, it was just a thing. Like, they really, they were just really, for some odd reason, against me being a part of the song. And then when the song began to become successful, I don't know if they looked at that like it was a bad thing that they were wrong, but I'm just looking at it like, man, if you got a hit record, it's a hit record.
Yeah.
And you just show love to the people. Like, I wasn't asking for any special attention. I was just asking for the just due recognition that I deserve for contributing a great deal.
Right. And they, like, it's like the least, the very least that you can do.
Yeah. No, I had to go to Ludacris himself and be like, what's up, dog? Like,
that is wild.
I know you. Dang. We live in Atlanta. You gonna let this happen? I went to Poon. And they made a, you know, they made a their stink over it, and eventually Capitol came on in. But no, it was a, I mean, even hence the reason why we're just now getting to perform the song live now together. Like, Chingy was told at the height of the song that I was too busy to go on the road with him and perform the record. So, like, when he went on 106 and Park, and when he went on tour with the record, he was being told by whoever that I was unavailable, or that I wasn't willing to go on tour with him and perform the record.
That is some hater ass shit.
Yeah.
I will whoop Capitol Records ass.
But it was the truth, though.
Okay, so what are you doing now? Like, what's next for Jason Weaver? What can we expect?
Jason Weaver is still an on-screen personality or talent. But I'm focusing more of my energy into developing and producing content. I have a production company that I became a partner in recently alongside with Antonio Reed Jr., L.A. Reed's son. Great guy. Prowler Man, also known as Dantley Wyatt. He's one of my partners in Cage Parker. We have a animated series that we're in the middle of negotiating with a major cable network right now called The Secret Society. And that's across kind of like between The Sopranos and The Simpsons and Family Guy and all that. I know.
I'm in.
Yeah, but it's like really, really dope. I know. It has a heavy music component to it, being that we're guys from the music business. Uh-huh. So we'll have a lot of people coming on as guest voices that are familiar voices within music but are playing characters outside of themselves.
Oh, my gosh.
And the persona that they project, you know what I'm saying, as artists. So I have that. I also have the pleasure of working with another gentleman by the name of Joshua Leonard. He has another animated project that he created called Team Supreme, which is about kids of color who either have disabilities or have special needs or life-threatening illnesses. And in the hospital that they all hang out at and hang out with his doctor at, he takes their what perceived disabilities and turns them into superpowers. And so he gave me permission to move his. No, and it's actually really dope, though. And it's created by brother Joshua Leonard. I can say this on camera. Like, this dude is the next Stan Lee. Like, this dude is the next Dizzy. Like, he's creating.
That is a big statement.
No, it's huge. And he's a genius. His work ethic is unmatched. It's an honor and a pleasure to be working alongside with him.
I mean, talk about representation. Like, if you're a black disabled child,
right?
Like,
right.
That's huge.
No, it really is.
Oh man!
So I took it to a friend of mine. I won't mention her name because we're still developing it, but you guys will probably see it later on. But a friend of mine, very accomplished screenplay writer and producer, has decided to partner up with us on it and is going to usher us into the right network or the right platform to be able to put it out. So I'm doing that. And lastly, which is something I was just asking you about. I just launched a new sports and entertainment podcast called Statlines Matter.
I see what you did there.
Yeah, it's a little play on words, But I host that show alongside with my cousin and also accomplished music veteran and executive Mark Stewart. Mark was one of the former vice presidents for Epic Records. He's a partner in Red Zone Entertainment alongside with his brother Tricky Stewart, who's responsible for Single Ladies for Beyonce and Umbrella for Rihanna. Like, yeah, my cousins are like,
what?
Three of my cousins are like multiple Grammy Award winners. Tricky Stewart, Coo Carell. You guys can Google these names. Like, my family is like heavy into the music. They've won like Song of the Year. Like, and they're so much more wealthier than me. I host that show alongside with Mark and another one of our co-hosts who was a former A&R at Red Zone named Rob Hunter. And basically what the show is about is we give our take on sports and entertainment through the eyes of some guys in the music business. And what we attempt to do on each episode is to go deeper than surface. We're talking about issues not only, you know, related to sports, but related to culture and politically and socially and things that we as a people are kind of talking about amongst one another, but haven't been given the platform, so to speak, to be able to keep it real and really put our thoughts and our views out there in a very safe but yet intelligent form. So that's what Stat Lines Matter is doing. So any of you guys out there that are listening to this particular podcast, please take some time to go to Apple Music, go to SoundCloud, go to YouTube, go to our website, www.statlinesmatter.com. You can check out the episodes of the show and you can get a feel of what the show is about. But we've had the pleasure of interviewing Pro Football Hall of Famer Andre Reed. We got my man, The Dream, Terrius Nash. He's on it. We're gonna have we're gonna have Tip on it on one of these episodes. So yeah, that's what we do. We just give these athletes and we give entertainers an opportunity to kind of be across from one another and talk and have real conversation.
Yeah.
And ask each other the questions that, you know, they probably ask themselves in their minds, like, well, you know, what are they, you know, what do they feel about this and that? And instead of, you know, them having to give the cookie cutter answer like what they would probably do on ESPN or FS1.
Get to be yourself.
They can be themselves. Yes. And especially them as black men. You know, once they take off the shoulder pads and the helmet and all that and take off the uniform, who are you as a man? What do you stand for? What do you believe in? What are you about? What are you doing for the community? Like, past all that that you're doing. Yeah, I get the stats and the numbers and all of that.
Yeah.
But who are you?
I love
so that these kids and that the community knows. So that's what I'm doing now.
Amazing. Everybody download it right now.
Please do. It's a great show.
It's awesome. I'm even going to download it. And I don't think I've willingly watched a sports game in a while.
No, I mean, you'll enjoy it because most of the time with me, although I'm a huge sports fan.
Yeah.
I take the conversation to different places because, you know, that's just me. That's just my personality. But my other two co-hosts, like, they're sports nerds. They're encyclopedias. These guys know stats in the whole nine. So if you're one of those people that's in the stats and, like, real sports knowledge, we have two guys that are doing that great on the show. And if you just want to hear regular conversation and banter, you got me.
Amazing. I love it already.
Thank you.
I've had so much fun. I was so nervous.
Really?
Yes. Are
no
you kidding
need
me?
To be nervous. You're hella cool. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. No, oh, and can I say this before I leave too?
Yes.
Thank you guys, everybody at Strong Black Lead, for taking the time out to celebrate and recognize us. Those who have been in the business for a long time. We have a tendency, unfortunately, to get overlooked at times in our creative contribution, but it's things like this that not only help to educate the viewers and the listeners, but it also helps to refamiliarize people with who we are and what we've done in our career. And I just want to thank everybody involved with this production for allowing me to be a part of it. Thank you very much. It's been an honor and a blessing.
You're welcome. I'm glad that I could have put all this together by myself. I mean, it was hard. It was hard, but you know, it's not joking. Thank you so much.
Thank you,
Tracy. We're good. I think it's a wrap.
Appreciate it.